Hey, let's start you with a couple of announcements this morning. I'll just point out a few things that are in your bulletin and on the connection card. Don't forget, if you're interested in coming and learning more about True Life, come to the Discovering True Life class. That's on March the 12th from 4 to 8. You're not committing to join the church, or we're not going to start debiting your bank account directly or anything just because you show up for that. But we would like for you to sign up ahead of time because child care and dinner are provided. So you can drop your card in the offering boxes on the back wall beside the doors if you're interested in doing that. We have a new sermon series that's starting March the 12th, and that would be a good time if you're interested in getting into a small group to be in that small group, because we'll go through that for several weeks together. We have a curriculum for that. It's called the God Questions. And in your bulletin, March the 11th from 8 a.m. to noon, we'll be having a church work day. So if you can clean, if you can swing a hammer, if you can change a light bulb, we can find something for you to do, okay? Without further ado, welcome back, Motown Madness crew. Once again, we're going to hear from Jacob Wilkie this morning and several others. And I hear that there is a video of Jacob rapping that we might have to watch.
Motown Madness is when a bunch of churches in Morristown get together.
We have like 15 churches. It's really cool. There's a ton of people.
It's a weekend where you can get away from your normal life and just have fun with your friends learning about God.
I'd say an opportunity for Christians and non-Christians really to get together and learn more about God and our church and how to fellowship with each other.
The most fun you're ever going to have in your life. We stay at a host home and the parents just take us in like we're their own children, and it's a ton of fun. It's like one big sleepover, but with you just talk about God. It's like a Jesus sleepover.
Yeah.
We stay up pretty much all night. It's pretty rare to get more than 3 hours of sleep.
And it's just definitely a blessing to know that all the girls who were at my house can have my back whenever I need them.
It goes from everyone having fun, and then when it gets into the worship time, everyone focuses in and really takes the word in.
We had a lot of fun this weekend. Just to kind of recap, just to give you the smallest taste of what we did this weekend, other than not pack well, and I froze. we got to dive into the Word of God. We talked about his ministry and his life. We also talked about how he calls us. He calls us to be on mission, not just on youth groups, not just at Honduras time, not just at Motown Madness, but, and I'll give you a hint, it's on our shirt, right here, right now, all the time. And it's so exciting to see these guys and girls just diving into the Word of God, being excited for each other, and having an opportunity. We've got several people who are going to come up and talk to you guys just real briefly about our weekend, just to give you a personal testimony of what we've done and how it's affected them. So who wants to go first? Ethan does. All right, Ethan does.
Okay, yeah, this is on. Okay, so I don't have a lot of time allotted to me for this, so I can't take up all of Tommy's time, because Tommy's supposed to be speaking. But if you have not been to Motown or not able to go to Motown yet, let me tell you, it is the best experience of your life. We do so much stuff. All right, so I'll just give you a quick rundown of how this went. You know, went the first night, had a lot of fun, you know, was introduced to the band, the pastor teaching, and then we went to the host homes, hung out, dude. We did all kinds of stuff. The free time, we played football games. It was just a lot of blast. Grew close to the Lord. I just, what? What, guys? What?
A lot of
blast. Oh, we had a blast. I think I was thinking had a lot of fun and a blast at the same time. We had a blast, all right? It was just amazing. And one of my favorite Motown moments, I think my Motown moment was when Jacob raps. Can we see this?
Well, when a Tweedledee fights, it's called a Tweedledee battle. When they battle in a puddle, it's a Tweedledee puddle battle. When the Tweedledee battle.
Motown is just an amazing experience for anybody wanting to go. I'd encourage anybody that wanted to go. I know the high school boys always have a fun time. I don't know about everybody else, but can I hear hype from the high school boys? Come on, come on. Woo! All right, now all you other can, you know, if you want. You know, Motown.
All right, here you go.
You want me to? I'll drop it on you. So,
you hear me?
All right, cool. It's a really fun experience. We all stay up late, and we talk about God, and we have small groups in the morning, at night, and then we go to church service in the morning, and then at night, and we just worship, talk about God, you know, and they have a sermon, and quick little story about what we did last night, right? He's laughing at me. So we all were sleeping in a basement, right, and it, you know, it got cold last night, and we all had our own blanket, and my boy Zach right here, we all wake up, and we're all sharing a blanket, and we're all, like, snuggling.
Picture.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, Ethan pretty much summed it up. I highly suggest it to any youth that is coming or ever wants to. It's a really fun experience.
All right, guys.
Hey guys, how's it going? All right, I got one thing to tell you. This is the thing I took away from the most from the weekend. Hang on. Are you ready? Jesus plus nothing equals everything.
Okay, so this weekend we were faced with three questions. We were the first night with our first session. I wasn't there for that one, but we were faced with here and now, are you following Jesus? And so I guess everybody else can tell you about that, but I wasn't there. So then the second session, I was at that one. It was about here and now, what's keeping you from obeying Jesus? So we were really faced with just asking God to reveal those things to us that we need to surrender. So it was about finding the things that we think are giving us life, but are really robbing us of truly finding it. So then that's whenever Jesus plus nothing equals everything. We were just finding that whenever we just find the giver of life and then just leave everything else, then that's when we truly find life. And then the third night, or whatever, the third session, we were faced with here and now, are we sharing Jesus? So we were told that 3 out of 4 people that we go to school with every day don't know Jesus, or they maybe know about him but don't really know him or aren't walking with him. So we were just faced with what are we doing about it? So we were faced with I think it's Matthew chapter 10. Okay. And we read about how the harvest is plentiful but the laborers are few. And so we just thought about those things and thought about what are we going to do about it. And so we're supposed to pray, and we're supposed to ask God to save people, but to empower us to be the laborers that are going to be able to experience the harvest.
So that's our Motown moment. If you are on social media, you can follow the hashtag MyMotownMoment and see all sorts of shenanigans and stuff. Thank you, Host Homes, for having us. It is awesome to be able to just be part of your families for a weekend. So that's our Motown moment.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Sounds like a lot of fun. It makes me wish that I wasn't a middle-aged man. I'd just go. You'll accept me? Well, thank you. I think that was a pretty good rap, Jacob, because it sounded like all other rap songs. It had a really good beat, and I couldn't understand anything you were saying. So, why don't y'all take a minute and greet one another. If you see somebody you don't know, make them feel welcome this morning.
This heart open wide from the depths, from the heights of the sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry, a sacrifice.
Thank you.
blessed be your name. When found in a desert place, nor walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, oh, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name.
Time this morning, as I was praying about this week and seeking the Lord's wisdom and guidance on it. Typically, when you ask for that, when I ask for it, shortly He directs me somewhere to a scripture, to an idea. This time, how it came back was just pray. We don't need to go look at the scripture. We know how to pray. It's just talking to God. So, what's on your heart this morning? That song covers a lot of territory related to this. Maybe you're walking on cloud nine. You're in the midst of a mountaintop experience. So just bless His name this morning. Just bow your heads right now. Just bless His name and praise Him this morning for the good things in your life, for the goodness you see around. Maybe you're in a low place. Maybe you're hurting this morning and wondering why. Let's cry out to God. If the Spirit moves you this morning, there's somebody here that you think needs your prayers, go to them. Because you don't get everything that you've asked for doesn't mean He's not good. It doesn't mean you. Sometimes those things we're asking for are not the right things. Father, we bless your name in this place. And that's what we've come to do, and that's what we're called to do, Father. And I pray that nothing would stand in our way and keep us from doing that. No fear, no resistance from the enemy, Lord. I pray that you would crush that this morning. And I lift up those to you who are hurting this morning. They may not even have the words to pray this morning. Their spirits will grow with the words that cannot be expressed this morning. You know why they're hurting, and you know how to heal them, Lord, and I pray that you will do that. And I join those who are in a great place, who are on the mountaintop with you, and rejoicing. Lord, we praise your name, we bless your name, we thank you for the good things you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Oh,
earth has no sorrow, heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't
the mighty fortress is not-
Were it not for your great grace and mercy, we'd be consumed, Lord, for the sin that comes against your holiness. We thank you this morning for that grace and mercy in Jesus' name. Amen. Kids, you can go out for children's church. Everyone else, you can have a seat.
What is happening, True Life Church? It is so, so awesome to be with you guys today. Man, what an awesome day it is. Can I get a real big amen from you guys? One, two, three, amen. Hey, we're going to do that one more time. And man, listen, you better scream it as loud as you can. Or guys in the sound booth, I want y'all to replay this over and over until it gets to the point where people are excited. So I want a good amen from everybody in the house today at True Life Church. Ready? One, two, three. Amen. That's right, baby. That's right, baby. It's really, really good to be with you guys today. And I don't know about y'all, but is it not just good to be in church today? Look at your neighbor and say, man, it's good to be here today. Go ahead. Look at your neighbor and say, it's good to be here today. Yeah. Now look at your other neighbor, who, by the way, was your second choice, and say, it's good to be next to you today. Say it. It's good to be next to you today. Well, my name is Josh Cardwell, guys, and I am the pastor of Revolution Church in Crossville, Tennessee. I've been with you guys several times before, preached for you guys, done a couple of youth events for you guys, or I think one youth event for you guys. And I just want to thank you guys for having me today as you guys are nearing the end of your series, Don't Just Go to Church, But Be the Church. I just want to thank your pastor, Pastor Jimmy, for having me this weekend. I don't know if you guys know how blessed you are to have this guy as your pastor. Obviously, I'm wearing my cat shirt just for him because of how much he loves cats. But I want you to know, man, our church has been going for about three and a half years. And right now, we're running about 550 to 600 people a week in a small town of about 30,000 people. And the person that was with me really a year or two before we even launched the church and really got going, he was encouraging me. He let me know if I needed anything. It was your pastor, Pastor Jimmy. He's a great guy. He's a godly man. He loves you guys. He loves your city. He loves your county. He wants to reach people, and he wants you guys to fall in love more with Jesus and be more like him. So I just want to say, man, let's give Pastor Jimmy a big hand clap. He's an awesome, awesome guy. Get loud, get loud. Yes, yes, yes. So, well, he's asked me to come today and speak to you guys. And, you know, you've got another week of this series, Don't Go to Church, Be the Church. And so what I'd like to talk to you guys today about is being the church as far as it goes in reaching people. The church word for this would be evangelism, if you're new to True Life or you've never been in church or whatever and you're visiting today with us. And so what do we do when we say we're supposed to be the church? Man, I've got this heart and this mission, and I think this is why Jimmy asked me to speak to your church today. I've got this heart and this mission to reach people. I definitely have the gift of evangelism. Our church has had so many people baptized, so many people saved, and my heart is to see the church be evangelistic and do everything they can in order to reach people. And I just want to tell you guys this. Listen to me. If you're going to reach people in Jefferson City, then I'm going to tell you this. You're going to have to reach people that probably are not a whole lot like you. You're going to have to reach people that are nothing like you. In Crossville, Tennessee, we give T-shirts out. We give out probably 5 to 10,000 T-shirts a year at our church because that's how we market the church, and people wear them and people ask about it, and then they come to church. And it's really interesting in our church that sometimes every once in a while I'll check the mugshots in Crossville and I'll check the runaway page on Facebook. And just about every single month you can see on the mugshots page or the runaway page for the kids, you can see a Revolution Church T-shirt. It will say in big bold letters, "No perfect people allowed." One of our other shirts says, "Messed up person, perfect savior." Another one says, 0% perfect, 100% forgiven. And people are probably looking at that thinking, boy, they really are living what they believe there, right? You know what I mean? But a lot of people would look at that though and say, man, I'm horrified I can't believe that people are wearing our shirts when they're getting their mugshots taken. And I look at that and I say, praise God. Praise God that God used us to reach someone that obviously needed Jesus. I love it when police officers come to me and they tell me about when they do drug raids in Crossville. And I had one guy come to me one time and said, we did a drug raid on a house, and sitting on the countertop of this meth house was Revolution Church cards. And I say to that, praise Jesus, because those are people that we need to be reaching. All different kinds of people are the people we need to be reaching, because Jesus loves all people. And my job here today is to encourage you and get you fired up about reaching all different types of people in your city, in your workplace, in your family that are your friends. Because let's be honest, guys, for a lot of people that go to visit a church or go to a church or are seeking the gospel, or people that maybe aren't even seeking, their church experience is a pretty miserable one. For most people, their church experience is they walk into a place, they see a bunch of people that look like they don't even want to be there, they don't even smile, you know what I'm saying? And their church experience is just this terrible thing, and that's why the church is declining so much today, is because the church doesn't realize the great commission that we've been given. Not a small commission, a great commission in order to reach people. So I want to go to Mark chapter 2 today and preach on a story that you guys have probably heard preached on several times before. It's one of the bedrock stories and foundational stories for Revolution Church and really for the church in general, because it gives us such a wonderful, clear picture of what reaching people in the Gospels is and what our role is, and some pointers and tips that we can pick up in Mark chapter 2. So if you guys are with me, Mark chapter 2, everybody say, yeah, buddy, on the count of three. One, two, three. Yeah, buddy. Here we go. This is what it says. It says this: a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it, and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." So this is what we have going on in this particular story. We've got a man that needs Jesus, needs healing, needs a miracle in his life. And Jesus has hit town, if you will, having a revival at someone's house. And everyone in town hears about it. So they come running and they pack the place out. If you read further in the story, it gives us some details that we're going to talk about of some people that were actually in the house listening. But the house is so full of people that the man who needed the miracle, the man that needed to be touched by Jesus, the man that needed his sins forgiven, the man that needed to be healed by Jesus could not even get inside the house because it was so packed. Well, four guys that brought the man, they see that it's full. And they realize it, and they say, we got to do something to get this guy to Jesus. They dig a hole in the roof. They lower the guy down. Jesus forgives this man. And if you read further, it actually says that he heals the man. I want to tell you about really two things. We may get into three things today that we need to do as the church, as the ecclesia, as it says in Matthew chapter 16, which is the called out ones, the people of the church, if we are going to reach people. Three things that this passage of Scripture, we may just get to two, three things that this passage of Scripture tells us to do. The first thing is we've got to bear some burdens. We've got to bear some burdens. If you look in verse 3, it says this: some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. These four men carry this guy in and bear this guy's burdens and carry his burden. They actually have his weight on them in order to get him to Jesus. And I'm going to tell you guys something. Listen to me as I say this. We've been taught for years in the church that drive-by evangelism is super effective. We've been taught that when you meet someone in an elevator, man, just ask them three questions. If you were going to die tonight, what would you say in front of the Lord to get into heaven? And by the time you get to the fifth floor, they're going to be a Christian. And that's what evangelism is. But I'm telling you what reaching people is, the first thing we do is we have to carry some burdens. We have to bear some burdens. I'm going to tell you something. People are already skeptical about the church. They already think we don't care about them. They already think that preachers just want their money. They're already skeptical about the church. And so what we have to do is we have to bear some burdens. What does that mean? That means when someone is hurting, you listen to them. You have two ears and one mouth for a reason. You listen to them. That means when someone's mom dies, that you go to the funeral. That means when someone has a baby, you're there for them to visit them in the hospital. That means when someone is sick, you bring them a meal, because we're all ministers. This is not just Pastor Jimmy's job. This is not just the staff's job. This is being the church, bearing some burdens, you know? And I'm just going to tell you guys, listen. You are going to have to bear some burdens and reach some people that are absolutely nothing like you. Let me just give you one example. Old folks that are in here, I want you to raise your hand if you're in here. If you're True Life Church, where's my old folks at? Maybe just one or two people raising their hand. I don't know. But young folks, where's my young folks at? Y'all raise your hand. Everybody in here thinks you're all young, okay? You're all young, okay? But let me tell you something. What this means is, old folks, guess what? We got to raise up the next generation, and we've got to deal with millennials and young people that are going to drive you crazy, that are lazy, and they don't know nothing about no hard work, and all they do is sit around and play video games. And when I was young, I had a job when I was 13, and these are 28-year-olds that sit in their mom's basement and play video games, and you are going to have to deal with them. You've got to pour into them. You've got to bear some burdens for them. You've got to have some patience for them. Young folks, what this means for you is you're going to have to put up with some of us old folks. And guess what? We're a little grumpy. We are a little grumpy. We're a little grumpy. We always want to tell you every single thing you've done wrong at least 5 to 10 times, because we want to make sure you know how wrong you are. We always have experience in everything. And the reason we kind of try to give you warnings is because most of the things you're doing that are dumb and that don't work, we've been there, we've done that, and we don't want you to make those mistakes. But you're going to have to bear some burdens with us. You're going to have to put up with us. Man, you're going to have to be the church in the sense that we've got multi-generations, all different types of people. It's not cookie-cutter religion. It's all different types of people. And we've got to bear each other's burdens. And we've got to have patience and be able to put up with people. Listen to me as I say this phrase. I know you've probably heard this many times before, but people don't care how much you know till they know how much you care. If you're going to reach people, you're going to have to bear some burdens and carry some burdens for some folks, because they don't care that you're a Christian till they know that you love them. At True Life Church, what we need to realize is we don't just invite people, we bring people. Huge difference between inviting and bringing. We're not just looking for people to make a decision to follow Jesus. Nowhere in Scripture does it say to simply make a decision. We are looking to create disciples for Jesus. That's the Great Commission, bearing some burdens in order to reach people. Well, I want you to see the next thing, and we've got time, so I'm going to get into this. I just want to point this out to you really fast. If we move on to the end of verse 3, here we are in verse 4, it says, since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd. Now, I know that's a weird verse to take out of context, but if you read the rest of this story, and I would highly encourage you to read it, because it tells us some of the people that were in the house, they couldn't get this guy into Jesus for a miracle, for healing, and for his sins to be forgiven, because the house was too packed out. And I just want to make this point to you, that the people that were inside the house, the people that were inside the house were people that had turned their backs on the very person that Jesus wanted to reach the most. The person that needed the biggest miracle, the person that needed his sins forgiven, the people that were inside the house kept their backs turned to him because their comfort and their spot was more important than Jesus helping the hurting and reaching the people that needed a miracle. If you read later on in this story, it tells us that the highly religious, the Pharisees, were in the house, probably on the front row in the seats of great prominence, because we see that they start to criticize Jesus after this man gets healed and has his sins forgiven, and there's this conflict that Jesus has with these religious leaders. And I just think it's so funny because some of us end up in a place like these religious leaders where we turn our backs on the people that God wants us to reach and wants the church to help. Where we get to a place where we say, I'm not giving up my seat. This is my seat. This is my pew. This is my parking place. Who's this new person walking in? This is my church. This is my ministry. This is my small group. Now, I know we don't struggle with that in the church today, because what we do is we just tell you if you'll give $100, we'll put a little plaque on your seat, right? That has your name on it, so everybody knows in the whole church and anybody that ever comes that it's not God's pew, it's your pew. Hello? You know what I mean? And so we've got to realize that we cannot turn our backs on the very people that Jesus wants us to reach. I think it's interesting when you read this story. I mean, it dawned on me that no one would let this guy in. Because for the people that were in the house, it was all about me, me, me. My comfort, my comfort, my comfort, my comfort. And it amazes me how in the church, people get so caught up in their own comfort and forget about reaching people. It amazes me how people, I've been a pastor for 3.5 years, and I'm sure Pastor Jimmy is no different. He's heard all kinds of stuff. Well, I want Sunday school because I like Sunday school. Well, I want expository preaching because I like expository preaching. Well, I want subject preaching because I like subject preaching. And I want more small groups. And I think we need to do a service on Wednesday night. And I think we should do a service on Friday night. And I think we should do a service on Sunday night at midnight. And I think we should do, man, shut up. Please stop. It's not all about you. It's about God using his church in order to fulfill the purpose that he has for them. Can I get a good amen, True Life Church? 1, 2, 3, amen, amen. If you're a Christian, the church does not exist to rub your feet and coddle you and give you everything you want. If you're a Christian, you are now a part of the army that fights the greatest war that has ever been fought on this earth. And you are called to further God's kingdom. So quit worrying about your comfort. Quit worrying about your traditions. And start worrying about people getting saved. It amazes me how people choose comfort over conversion. How people choose getting what they want over their kids being raised in a Christian home. It's amazing to me. I've got this these memes that I really, really enjoy, guys. And I want to show you a couple of them because I think it just perfectly describes the way some of us get sometimes when we get so selfish and so comfort-oriented and it's all about us. And of course, it's of a cat because your pastor loved cats so much. So I've tried to use cats as much as I can during this sermon. So this is called Grumpy Cat. And let me just read you some of these. This is how some of us are as it pertains to church and the critical spirit we get sometimes. 2017, it can only get worse. That's how some of you guys were a couple months ago on New Year's. You're like, 2017 is not going to be any better. So here's the next one. It says, what a beautiful day. Let's go back inside now because I don't want to be outside during a beautiful day. What a beautiful day, but I don't want to go to church. I don't know, you know. Here's one. If you don't have anything nice to say, good. good. Some of y'all, man, that's the way church is to you, man. You're just like, man, we ain't going to say nothing nice because we got to criticize every single thing. And what I'm trying to get through to you is don't do that, okay? This is what it says. Here's the next one. What doesn't kill you will hopefully try again. I don't know. Maybe some people have thought that. I think this is the last one here. And it says, some people just need a high five in the face with a hammer. I don't know. I don't know what we're doing here. But anyway, don't turn your backs on the very people that Jesus wants to reach. Don't turn your backs on the very people that Jesus wants to reach. To reach people that aren't like you, you're going to have to get uncomfortable. You're going to have to realize that it's not all about what you want. Man, you are going to have to get uncomfortable, and you're going to have to turn around and face the very people that Jesus wants you to reach. My last point is this. This is my last one. I love what these guys do, because after they can't get in because it's so full, look what it says. Verse 4, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it, and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Last point is this. These guys did something crazy. These guys did something outside the box. These guys did something that you can't find in the Torah. You can't find it in the Old Testament where it says, thou shalt dig holes through roof in order to get to the Messiah so they can be healed. These guys broke some rules. These guys broke some rules. They broke some religious rules. And I'm going to tell you guys, if you're going to reach people that need to be reached, in our culture, if we're going to reach out to Jefferson City, and we're going to grab a hold of those people that need a miracle, that need to be healed, that need a touch from Jesus, that need their sins forgiven, then we are going to have to bear some burdens, and we are going to have to break some rules. I like breaking rules. Any other rule breakers in here? Raise your hand. Okay, are you sitting next to somebody that likes to break rules? Raise your hand. I don't know if anybody in here likes to break rules. Did anybody ever go swimming within 30 minutes after eating? You broke the rules. Did anybody in here ever ride your bike without wearing a helmet? I don't know. You broke some rules. You ever driven your car without buckling your seatbelt? I'm telling you, raise your hand if that's you. Okay, man, you people, we're going to have to repent at the end of this thing. Y'all are going to hell. I'm telling you, man. Have anybody in here ever ran with scissors in their hand or like you had a sucker in your mouth and your mom's like, don't run with a sucker in your mouth. It's going to impale your brain and kill you. And that never happened to you, but that's what she told you. You like to break some rules. I bet there are some rules breakers in here. I bet there's some people at True Life Church. Man, when you were a kid, you broke some rules and you sniffed a lot of magic markers, didn't you? Just admit it now. Raise your hand. I mean, y'all ate a whole lot of Elmer's glue when you were a kid. Man, they don't eat that glue. Your teacher's telling you and you're eating them. You're like Tommy Boy, ate a lot of paint chips when you were a kid, whatever. I can remember when I was younger, we broke the rules a lot. And most of the time that we broke the rules, it's because we wanted something awesome to happen. And I remember when I was a kid, one of my friends had a trampoline. Now, if you've seen trampolines today, you know that trampolines today have a protective net around them. Everything is padded. Like, it's basically like foolproof. Your kids get in there, they can do whatever, and they're not going to hurt themselves on the trampoline. I mean, they're like covered in Teflon, basically. But that ain't the way trampolines were when I was a kid. If any of you guys that are my age or older remember, trampolines used to have no protection whatsoever. Remember when you'd get your arm caught on one of the springs and it would pinch you? Or, man, if you got your hair caught in it, you may as well just cut it off because your hair is gone, right? And there was no protection. And it was insane. And so we used to always like to break the rules. And so my buddy had a trampoline. And so what we used to do was we used to pull the trampoline up right next to the house. And we used to jump off the roof onto that trampoline and then jump into the pool off the trampoline he had. And it was so awesome. We did it so much until one time, this is why I'd say kids don't do this ever, because my buddy broke his arm and it was pretty awesome because it wasn't me, it was him that broke his arm. But don't ever do that because of those reasons. And so, but man, we broke some rules so that we could see something awesome and see something incredible. And I'm telling you guys, in the church, If we want to see God do some awesome stuff, we got to break some rules. We got to break some religious barriers. Some of the things that we hold on to in those traditions, we got to get outside those things, and we got to break the rules in order to reach some people. We've got kind of a saying at Revolution Church that we will do anything short of sin in order to reach people. And I'm just telling you, in order to reach people that no one's reaching, man, True Life is going to have to do things that no one is doing. And you're going to have to get outside your comfort zone, and you're going to have to invite people and go after people and do something that God's never asked you to do before. You know, guys, you've got a sermon series that's starting in 2 weeks, and it's going into Easter, called the God Questions. Questions that basically people that don't know Jesus ask all the time. Creation versus evolution. What is there evidence for God being real? What a perfect opportunity for you to start inviting people, for you to become a social media evangelist and share everything and invite people and tag people in videos that True Life is going to be sharing and stuff like that. Man, you need to get people here for this series so that Jesus can heal them, so that they can have miracles take place in their life. You need to break some rules in order to do it. Right now, under your seat or on top of your seat when you came in, there should be two little index cards. And I'm going to tell you guys what to do with these index cards. I want to encourage you to do something with these. I want you to take these index cards, and right now, as you get a pen, right now, go ahead and pick them up. Pick your pen up in your seat, and I want everybody to do something. I want you right now, in this moment, as I'm talking, to pray about someone that God has put in your life that He wants you to break some rules and bear some burdens with and invite them to True Life Church. Man, tell them about the gospel. Stop and give them a hug, whatever it is. I want you to write those names down right now on this card. We did this once at our church. We had people write names down like the sign flipper at Pizza Hut. And we had a guy stop and invite the guy to church, and he ended up getting saved. We had people writing down family members' names. We had people writing down friends' names. We had people writing down husbands, wives, sons and daughters, cousins, dads and moms, kids. Whoever it is that the Holy Spirit is telling you, I'm supposed to reach them. I'm supposed to invite them in 2 weeks when we start this God question sermon and tell them, hey, we'll go out to eat lunch after church and it's on me. I'll buy your burritos, I'll buy your tacos, whatever, in order to get them to come to church. I want you right now on one of these cards, start writing those names down as I'm speaking. Let me help you in here. Some of you guys are like, I don't know what to write. Listen to me. Right now, even as I've been preaching this sermon, there have been people that are popping in your head and you've been thinking, man, I wish I could reach so-and-so. I wish I could get my husband. I wish I could get my daughter. I wish I could get my coworker to come to church with me just one time to hear the good news. I want to help you. That's the Holy Spirit of God telling you who He wants you to make an attempt at reaching, who He wants you to bear some burdens for, who He wants you to break some rules and get them to the feet of Jesus. Write those names down right now that God has given you. And this is what I want you to do with the other card. I want you to copy those names down. I want you to copy those names down. And every single Christian in this church should be participating in this. Every single Christian. Don't turn your back on this. And this is what we're going to do with one of these cards in just a moment when I turn it over to the person that's going to lead the altar call. I want you to bring one of these cards up to the altar. And I want you to sincerely lay them at the altar. Give them to God. Say a prayer if you want to. But give them to God. Ask God to open up opportunities. Ask God to open up doors for you to be able to reach whoever's on this card. The other card is for you to take. You tape it to your steering wheel. You tape it to your mirror at home. You start praying for these names. You start asking God, how am I supposed to present this? How am I supposed to start a conversation? God, open up doors for me. Open up conversations for me to be able to invite these people, because I know You've called me to reach these specific people. every person in True Life Church, we are called to be a part of reaching people. Not all of us have the gift of evangelism, but every one of us can be a part of reaching people, of reaching folks. I want to tell you this too. If you decide to do this and you decide to reach people, you need to know that it's not always going to be easy. There's going to be people just like in this story when the religious leaders see that Jesus did something awesome with this guy, they start to criticize. And every time Jesus does something awesome, every time Jesus is reaching out to the hurting, it's kind of funny because there are always people who criticize it. And I want you to know that you're going to have everything against you to reach these people that you're supposed to reach. But don't stop. Don't stop. You reach them for Jesus and do everything you can to get them. Guys, I'm going to pray. I'm going to be praying for you guys that this is the best spring True Life Church has ever had, that you reach more people over the next few months than you've ever reached, that you see miracles take place just like in this story where Jesus healed this guy and forgave him of his sins. Lord, we love you. We thank you so much for today. I pray for every single person under the sound of my voice, God, that as you've challenged us here today to reach out to people, to bear some burdens, to let people know that we love them, love God, love people, equally important. People don't care how much you know till they know how much you care, that True Life Church would truly start to bear some burdens, not turn their backs and say, it's too much drama, I don't need that in my life, this person isn't like me, I don't want to be around them because they smell or they talk different or they use bad language or their kids will be a bad influence on my kids. But God, give us compassion. Give us a heart to bear burdens for folks. God, give us the boldness to break some rules in order to reach some people. I pray for this church, God, that you would use it as a light to this community, and that your people, the church, would be the church, not think that the church is a website or a building or anything like that, but the church is the ecclesia, the called out ones. You've given us the keys. The gates of hell will not prevail against us. You said that we will do even greater things than you. So God, help us in our unbelief and help us to have faith to believe those things. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you, True Life Church. Love you guys.
Amen. What a gifted man of God. Amen. Thank God for Josh Cardwell. We're just going to do what he asked us to do today, and we're going to take those cards that you've written names on and bring them to the altar. If you need to just bow and pray for them, feel free to do that. Just go ahead and let's stand, and if you've got those cards ready, just go ahead and bring them to the altar and lay them before the Lord. And you keep the other card that you're going to continue to pray for and ask God to give you opportunities, give you open doors to do that. And just respond. Let's just respond to what this man of God has asked us to do in bringing those names to the Lord and placing them before him. Just how beautiful you are, For time's sake, we're just going to bring it to a close. Let me tell you a couple of things. We've got some tools here for you. People come to church. Why? Because of this? No, because a friend brings them. But you can use these tools. They're in your bulletin. We've got more here on the front. We've got more back in the vault lobby. You can use these to bring your friends to True Life for the God Questions series. And bring them to your small groups. Also, want to make a mention to our small groups. Your packets are ready in the workroom. So somebody from your small group needs to pick those up so that we can use these door knockers also to get the word out. We want to get as much of this word out to our community, to our friends, to come to the God Questions. And we're going to trust God to do what only He can do. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. See you next time.